I mean by multiplex concept of self and multiplex theory of action, which will eventually lead us to multiplex psychotherapy. So different theories in social sciences and in psychology in particular, you know, they are grounded on a certain concept of self. But the concept of self is usually implicit. It is not exposed. It's hidden in the background most of the time. However, the concept of the self determines how human behavior is explained, understood, and should be regulated. Islam as a religion and Islamic intellectual traditions, namely kalam, fiqh, and tasawwuf, they all embrace a multiplex concept of the self and explain, understand, and regulate human action through this conception. By taking on the multiplex concept of the self and theory of action, we can bring psychology and these Islamic disciplines into dialogue. So let's begin with what's the self? At the moment, we see three approaches in addressing this question: the materialist, idealist, and multiplex perspectives. According to the multiplex, according to materialists, a human being is nothing but the body. According to idealists, you know, a human being has mind. And when they say mind, sometimes they include soul also in the mind. So they take it together. But personally, I think this is a big mistake, you know, to conflate soul and mind together as if they are the same thing. From the multiplex perspective, a human being is constituted by body, mind, and soul. So tripartite or three levels constitute a human being. So you see that I separate mind and soul. Because soul is a metaphysical entity, it belongs to the metaphysical world. It could not be reduced or conflated to mind. So this tripartite concept of self is grounded on Islamic multiplex ontology, which is called Maratibul Vujud in Arabic. So from this perspective, there's material world and non-material world and the divine world. And in Arabic, this whole system is called Maratibul Vujud, which I translate to English as multiplex ontology or multiplex worldview. By the way, multiplex means multiple levels. In this perspective, there are three levels of existence. Conventionally, the existence is divided into two categories, physical and metaphysical worlds. But here, there are three levels because the level of the existence of Allah or God is differentiated from the metaphysical world, because we think that putting God or Allah as part of the metaphysical world is a big mistake, because the beings in the metaphysical world, they are created. Allah is the creator. So putting the creator and the created in the same category would be wrong. So the creator should be differentiated to stand alone at a different and distinct level of existence. So these three levels of existence is the Islamic multiplex ontology. So this is kind of reflected in a human being, because the world is macrocosm and the human being is the microcosm. And the human being is constituted by body, mind, and soul. So this is what I call multiplex human ontology. So a human being is like a bridge between the physical and metaphysical world. a human being is connected to both worlds. So how about the body? Body is part of the physical world, and physical body is something we commonly share with the animals. But our bodies are controlled by our metaphysical soul. Our soul controls our bodies, and bodily limbs are servants of the soul because they get commands from the soul and act accordingly. So body is not autonomous. Body doesn't act by itself. So there is a two-way communication between the body and the soul. Bodily needs are also communicated to the soul. The physical heart and the brain are the intermediaries between body and soul. And here the graph illustrates this, the physical heart and the brain mediates between body and soul. How about the mind? When we say mind, what do we mean? The term mind in Arabic is translated either as dimag or zihn. So two words used to translate mind. So that's why it is wrong to say mind. Mind includes, you know, soul as well. Mind indicates dimag and zihn, and the concept of vujud zihni is commonly used in Islamic disciplines. So mind or zihn is the emerging qualities and functions of the brain. So mind stands between soul and body. So commands for action reflecting the human being, human will to act in a particular way comes from the soul, and they are conveyed to the mind from the soul, and the mind, you know, conveys it to the body. But the reverse communication is also true. Information collected by the senses and biological needs and desires of the body are first conveyed to the mind, and from mind to the soul. So we, according to Imam Ghazali, and I am using Ghazali, but it does not mean, you know, these are specifically Ghazalian ideas. Ghazali represents the Islamic intellectual tradition. Most of the ideas presented by Ghazali are also shared many other scholars from the beginning of Islamic civilization until today. I just use Ghazali as an example. So he says that human beings have five physical senses. So all of us know that we have five external senses to collect data for the mind from the external world, like touching, sight, smell, taste, hearing. And he also says that we have five internal senses. You know, al-hawas al-zahira and al-hawas al-batina. So internal senses include imagination, takhayyul, tafakkur, thinking, remembering, tadhakkur, memory, hifz, and also al-his al-mushtarak, joint sense perception, a sense that incorporates and integrates all the data coming from separate sources to mind. So these are the senses in the mind. So Ghazali compares the operations of a human being with the operations of a state. So this is a good citation from his book, Ihya Ulumuddin, from the chapter on the heart. So he says, thus the heart appoints the eye over the world of colors, hearing over the world of sounds, smell or the work of others, and so on for the others. These are the bearers of news that they collect from their different worlds and transmit to the imaginative faculty in the brain, in the mind, which is like the master of the couriers. The letter in turn, the imaginative faculty, delivers them to the storage keeper, which is memory. The storage keeper sets them forth before the king, which is the heart, who selects therefrom that which he has need of in managing his kingdom. And the kingdom of the heart is the whole soul, mind, and the body in completing the journey ahead of him. So the journey ahead of us is the journey to Allah in subjugating his enemy, which is the Satan, by whom he is afflicted, and in warding off from himself those who cut off his path. If the king, the heart, does this, he is successful, happy, and thankful for the blessings of God the exalted. So this is an ideal scenario, the heart controlling everything in the mind and the body, which may not always work, orchestrating all powers in human beings as an army requires self-discipline, self-control, and it requires effort, which most people lack. So how about the soul? What's the soul? According to Ghazali, there are different terms used to indicate soul, like soul, heart, intellect, self, and in Arabic, ruh, kalb, akıl, nefs. You know, these are sometimes used synonymously to indicate the soul. But sometimes these four terms have distinct meanings as well. For instance, soul is considered the invisible metaphysical spiritual substance, and heart, again, you know, used for the physical heart, and at the same time the metaphysical spiritual substance, which is the knowing and perceiving essence of human beings, and intellect, akıl, you know, man's knowledge of the true nature of things, but at the same time it's used to indicate the power to perceive and know. And the nafs, again, has two distinct meanings. One of them, blameworthy qualities and animal powers in man. And the second meaning, metaphysical spiritual substance, which is the real essence of man. You see that these terms are either used synonymously to indicate what we call in English soul or spirit. But sometimes they are used for different meanings, so you have to be tentative to the context in which they are used. So among these terms, the most difficult one is the term nefs. It's very difficult to translate it to English, and we will talk about it. So human soul belongs to the metaphysical world, Alemul Melekut or Alemul Amr. The soul is part of the metaphysical world, and thus it can be a subject of empirical study only with respect to its impact on moral qualities, attitudes, and behavioral outcomes. So we can empirically study manifestations of the soul, but not the soul itself. Because it belongs to the metaphysical world, it's invisible. So Al-Ghazali accepts that there are two souls in human beings. So the one is the animal soul, which is the source of biological life, and it belongs to the material world. And the other one is the human soul, which is the source of spiritual life, and it belongs to the metaphysical world. So he says that the first soul, the animal soul, is the subject of medical science, And the second one is the subject of tasavvuf, Islamic spirituality. So the human soul or the spiritual heart has some faculties. The most important one is reason and nafs. So I translated nafs here as ego, and sometimes it's translated as appetitive self. And these two faculties of the soul always compete and conflict with each other. So this is the conflict between reason and nafs and ego. Sometimes you hear in common English, there is a conflict between mind and heart. Islamically speaking, there is no conflict, you know, between mind and heart. The conflict is between akıl and nefs, reason and ego. From this perspective, the heart is like a battlefield between these two faculties until the human person reaches peace by making reason control all actors of the sea. The metaphysical soul, the spiritual heart, is not fixed or stagnant. Instead, it's open to continuous change, conflict, and evolution. And the relationship between reason and self is decisive with regards to human character and action. So if you want to understand how a human being will act in a particular situation, we have to know how is the relationship between his akıl and his nefs, because this is how his action is determined. So the soul is networked or connected with the physical world through mind and body. So although the soul belongs to the metaphysical world, you know, and reason and ego, these are constituting elements of the soul. So they are connected to mind, and mind connected to body. So reason and appetitive self, they play a great role in the way the soul is connected to the mind. And external and internal senses, which I have explained above, they play a great role in shaping how the mind is connected to the body, or the body connected to the mind, because the communication always two ways. All right. So you see that there are three levels of existence, and also the soul has different faculties conflicting with each other. So managing and changing the self requires getting to know all these elements and controlling them and managing, administering their relations. And Imam Ghazali and other, you know, scholars in Islam, they call this siyasetul kalb, which can be translated to English as politics of the heart or governance of the heart. And siyasetul knowing or mastering, siyasetul kalb, politics of the heart, governance of the heart, is a prerequisite to manage and change the person and his actions. So from this perspective, they identified that there are three major levels or three major stages in a person's heart, which shape his behavior. So in this stage one, ego is the dominant one in the soul, and reason is subjugated to ego. So this is considered the lowest level of the heart. And in this stage, the ruling element is the appetitive self, and it is called an-nefsul ammara. So at this stage, the appetitive self, which is the voice of desires, rules the heart and the human person, and the actions are produced accordingly. So in stage two, a conflict begins between reason and ego. So this is a stage of disillusionment and awakening from the domination of ego. At this stage, a person becomes critical of himself. And this is called nefsul lawame. So this is a transitory state from the complete domination of the desires to the complete control of reason. So it is an intermediate level. And a person swings between the following reason and following ego, and most people are at this stage. And the stage three, which is the ideal stage for a human being, it is called the content self or the happy self. And in this stage, reason controls ego, nefs. So this is the ideal human being in whom reason is the dominant element and the ruling power. At this stage, the intellect becomes the sole ruler of the self. This is a great inner revolution. You know, after a big struggle between reason and ego, this is freedom from the enslavement of passions, desires, and ego. So how can we, like, what's a human action, and how can we explain human action if we ground our theory of action on multiplex self? The first thing we need to state is that human action is intentional performance of an act. So if there is no intention, a movement is not considered an action. So human action is a joint production of soul, mind, and body. So these are the three elements that make up human existence, and action is produced jointly by soul, mind, and body. Human action, according to Muslim scholars, has two levels: the external level and the internal level, zahir and batin. So the external level is the observable level, and the internal level is the unobservable level. The levels of self, maratibun nefs, are the key to understand and explain human action, naratibul amel, as there is a causal relationship between intentions and actions. So Muslims developed two disciplines to study human action. One is fiqh. It focuses on the external level of human action, the zahir, and another discipline is tasawwuf. It focuses on the internal level of human actions, which is a performance by the heart. So the multiplex theory of human action is based on the assumption that the ultimate control center of a human being is the soul, which is also called heart, intellect, reason, or the self. So the heart is the knowing, deciding, and acting human agency, the controlling human agency. The body and the limbs are just tools or servants or armies of the heart. What moves the heart to act are the khawatir, or the ideas coming to the heart or emerging from the heart. So Ghazali clearly states that the source of actions are khawatir. So these khawatir, these ideas come to heart either from the body or mind, or come from God, from angels, or from Satan. So different sources for the khawatir. But these ideas emerging in the heart creates desires, or they give rise to the desires. And once some of the these desires turn into determination, if they are persistent, then they turn into intention, and intentions turn to will, and the will is conveyed from the soul to mind and to body, and the body acts according to the will. So from this perspective, the primary agency of human action is the soul, and there are processes in the soul, in the heart, and these processes eventually are conveyed by the mind to the body, and the body is the subordinate agency of human action. So this is how human action is produced. As I have already stated, the soul is not fixed, it's not static. There are many conflicts going on in the soul, and also it is very liquid, fluid, it's open to change. So how are the relations between multiple self and action constantly refigured? I make five structural observations. The first one is that the self, seen from this multiplex human ontology perspective, is not static, it's fluid, dynamic, open to change, either to positive or negative way, depending on the influences it gets. Second, the heart is the ultimate decision maker and the control center of the self. It controls the mind and the brain, which in turn controls the body. Third, reason and ego clash to take control of the heart and the human being. Fourth, the conflict between reason and ego determines the state of the heart. Fifth, the state of the heart determines the quality or character of action at both visible and invisible levels. So if you want to understand why a human being acts in a way he or she does, you know, you have to know the state of the heart and the inner conflicts. Because the common question for all social sciences is to respond to the question of why do human beings act in a way they do. So that's the common question for all social sciences, and this is the methodology Islamic disciplines offer to address that question. Basically, you know, there are two levels of human action, visible and invisible, but you have to know the state of the heart to be able to understand and explain human action. So from these explanations, we can arrive to the conclusion that there are three types of self. From the Islamic spirituality perspective, the purpose of studying the soul is not to understand the true nature of or essence of the soul, because this is beyond our understanding, but to grasp its attributes, changing states, and manifestations in human actions, you know, on the body. You know, and the body is the is used as the servant or the tool of the soul. So the dominant faculty in the heart, either the reason or the ego, determines the state of the heart, and the state of one's heart determines his intentions, motivations. One's intentions determine his actions. So from this perspective, we can arrive to three types of self. So the type one self, where ego is the dominant faculty, and the ruling power is the appetitive self, or and this is what we call an nefs al-ammara, and the intentions are purely selfish, hedonist or egoistic, and the actions are immoral, but they may be seemingly good, you know, if the person wants to show off, or openly bad. So the type 2 self, where there is no ultimately dominant faculty, either ego or reason dominates, so it swings between the two, oscillates between the two. So this type 2 self is called critical self, and nefs al-lawwame, because he is aware of his mistakes, and the intentions, you know, emerging in type 2 self, sometimes selfish, sometimes otherish, you know, sometimes egoistic, sometimes altruistic, and the actions produced by type 2 self are generally immoral, but sometimes maybe moral, because there is no standard and it is not stable, because it's moving between reason and ego. And type 3 self is controlled and guided by reason, and it is called the content self, because reason is the dominant element and ruling element, and it's called an-nafs al-mutmainna, the happy self, and his actions are characterized by being purely altruistic, purely pro-social, otherish, and the resulting actions always moral. It's very stable, and they are internally and externally good. How does the type of self affect behavior? So if the ruling element is ego, then one goes between extremes, so either cowardly or aggressive, between two two extremes. So this is called hawa. So the ego follows his hawa, and hawa means unlawful, excessive desires. So sometimes they are deficiently excessive, sometimes they are excessive, more than, like, transgressing the boundaries. But in the content self, moderation is followed, and the moderation is the courage. So the courage is between cowardliness and aggression. So this moderation is a common universal value. You find the value of moderation in Greek philosophy, as well as in Eastern philosophies and religions. So this is something that Muslim ethicists or Sufis and philosophers also share with the ethical systems from other civilizations and religions. And similarly, like a stinginess, extravagance, these are two extremes, and generosity is the golden middle way. And timidity and self-confidence, like excessive self-confidence, these are two extremes. And dignity is the golden middle. And insensibility, hypersensitivity, these are two extremes. And temperance is in the middle. So you see that when one is controlled by ego or by appetitive self, or and at the state of nefs emmara, which is the type one self, so that person swings, you know, between two extremes and misses moderation. And the multiplex psychotherapy, it is grounded on the conception of a multiplex self and action. It aims to find out the root causes of the psychological disorders and mental distress by taking into account the state of the heart. So the state of the heart may be the root cause of some of the psychological disorders. It focuses on the health of the heart and soul. This is because cognitive, behavioral, and emotional well-being is more about the health of the heart than about the mere mental health. So I am introducing two concepts here. One is the mental health, and the other is health of the heart or spiritual health. These are two different things. Spiritual heart, spiritual health, or health of the spiritual heart, is the subject of Islamic spirituality. But the mental health may also become subject for Islamic spirituality, but if it's based on purely physical mental illness, so these are not the subject of tasawwur. So what's diagnosed as mental illness by psychology is usually at the same time a spiritual illness from the perspective of multiplex psychotherapy. But sometimes, if it's based purely on physical mental illness, so it is not subject for tasavvur. So this is very important to make a distinction between mental illness and spiritual illness, and also separating mental illnesses into two categories. Some of the mental illnesses are based on some physical malfunction in the brain, but some of them are not based on physical mental illness. So that's why multiplex psychotherapy searches for how to elevate a person from type 1 self to type 3 self, because type 3 self is considered healthy, you know, spiritually healthy. And in other words, how to reform the self from discontent, egoism, to content, altruism. So this question is addressed by Sufis, and they offer several methods for this reform or for this treatment, you know, elevating a person from the level of type 1 self, nefs emmara, to type 3 self, nefs mutmainne. So love, service, fellowship, God consciousness, or dhikr, you know, these are like very important methods used to cure the illnesses of the heart, amrad kalbiye. So marad kalbi, the illness of the heart, this is a Quranic concept. So this is how the illnesses in the heart are treated and cured. And also minimalism and contentment, riyadat nefs, and struggle to perfect inner deeds, mujahada. Among the Sufis, you know, there are two schools for spiritual treatments. So one school is the school of Halva Dar Encumen. This is, I translate as detached involvement in society. So one should be part of society, continue his life in society, should not withdraw from society, and while functioning as part of society, one's spiritual illnesses or mental illnesses can be cured. The other school is the school of seclusion, the Halwa school. So they say one should withdraw from society for a period until the treatment, the spiritual treatment, is completed. So this is the riyada or halwa method. So one should leave society for a period until the spiritual treatment is completed. But the first one, the Halwa Dar Encumen method, does not require leaving society, does not require seclusion. It defends the method of solitude within society. So in conclusion, I'd like to repeat that human ontology is the foundation of our psychology, and multiplex human ontology offers an alternative model to explain human action based on the following premises. First, human ontology is multiplex. A human being is constituted by body, mind, and soul. Second, the self is multiplex, ruling appetitive self, critical self, and content self. Three, different states of the heart cause different intentions, which in turn cause different actions. Therefore, we can say that the states of the heart are the root causes of human action. The states of the heart are the root causes, and intentions are the causes of the actions. And reforming actions requires reforming the heart, which is the root cause of the actions. And thus, the therapy must focus on the heart, must begin from the heart. A healthy heart is the one ruled by the reason, which manifests itself in one's inner life as contentment, happiness, and peace, and in observable outward actions as coherence, moderation, and stability. Again, if you go back to the question I posed in the beginning of my presentation, how are we going to integrate psychology and Islamic spirituality? My argument is that by employing the multiplex concept of self and theory of action, we can integrate psychology and Islamic spirituality more easily and bring them into a dialogue. So forget everything I said in between, but remember this argument from this presentation and take it with you to your homes. Thank you very much. This is the end of my presentation. And if you have any questions, I'll be happy to address them.
Thank you very much, Dr. Recep. This was extremely informative. And I think what you've really done is to demonstrate the richness of Islamic intellectual heritage here. And I think there's a huge gap that seems to be missing in our training that you are that you're addressing, and that is that we typically, in psychology and in cognitive neuroscience, we typically focus on the physical, the physiological, the body. We even engage in the mental processes and cognitive, but we don't have any sort of explanatory notions, or that's the ceiling that we stop at in understanding where does human will come in from, volition, creativity, insights, the sort of metaphysical components, I think, is something that has been largely abandoned in the field of psychology and has been left into philosophy. But you really provided a way to be able to really expand that dialogue and to give ourselves a better appreciation of the of a holistic picture on the human self. I want to take a look at any of these questions to see if they're try to pose some of these questions. Can you speak to, I think one thing that comes in the minds of people, and I noticed, is could you clarify between the physical and the metaphysical heart? Because you've used the word soul, and then you've used the word heart a couple of times. And in your diagram, we had physical, body, and heart, and soul above it. Could you give us a little bit of a clarification there?
So this is confusing to most people, you know, who are not deeply familiar with the terminology. As I have mentioned in my presentation, soul, heart, reason, and self are sometimes used synonymously to mean the same thing. But sometimes they are used for distinctive meanings. So depending on the context, you have to decipher whether they mean the soul, they mean that distinctive meaning attributed to it. So that's why it's very important to know when they are used synonymously and when they are used for distinctive meaning. So this is in Arabic, and it's not easy to properly translate them to English. Especially the concept of self is very confusing when you, like nafs, how do you translate it to English? Because nafs sometimes means the soul, sometimes it means ego, sometimes it means appetitive desires, you know, sometimes it means the self. So even in Arabic, it's very confusing. So and also it's very important to make the distinction between the spiritual heart and the physical heart. So here, we don't deal with the physical heart, because the physical heart is the subject of medical science or biology or anatomy. You know, we are not interested in this. We are interested in the metaphysical heart or the spiritual heart, which is synonymous with the soul. So that's why sometimes we have say heart, sometimes we say soul, like ruh or kalb, same meaning, synonymously used. But sometimes kalb has another meaning. So that's why it might be confusing from time to time. But here again, in my presentation, I drew the attention of the audience to the fact that heart sometimes means the soul. Okay. Yes.
Yes. So depending on the context, it can be used to refer to the physical heart. It can be used to refer to the soul, the metaphysical yes. component of the human being.
Yes.
There's also another question, Hojam, that says that asks for a bit of clarification. I think you talked about it a little bit in the last slide. about the work of the heart being within the realm of the sheikh, and how do you differentiate between, say, what people might be doing in tasawwuf or Sufism, focusing on the spiritual development. Meanwhile, you were able to illustrate that we cannot exclude